All right, everybody. Hey, each one of us here today have a unique opportunity. And I know what you're thinking, because I was once like you. I was skeptical. But if you follow this simple plan, you can reach the end of your life and be rich. And we all want that, don't we? Good. Now, let me tell you about this exciting opportunity. It's called Flock. And it's a rewards-based program, but you don't have to sell anything. And you won't be directly compensated by money, but you will be storing up treasure in heaven. Now, are there any questions so far? Yes, be there.
Maybe I'm the only one who's confused here, but I thought I was coming to a barbecue. Yeah. What exactly are we talking about?
Thanks for asking that, Sarah. And thanks for being here. FLOCK is an acronym that stands for Funneling Lives Over to Christ's Kingdom. Now, how many of you would say you talk to other people? Everybody, right? How many of you would say you talk to at least 3 people in one day? Here's how it works, Sandy. You talk to 3 people and bring them to church. Do you have 3 friends? Those 3 friends, in turn, talk to 3 more people and bring them to church. These 12 people make up your core flock. Now, once you achieve 12 people in your core flock, you reach the level of Golden Shepherd. Who's ready to sign up right now?
Inviting someone to church doesn't have to feel like a pyramid scheme. Just ask.
Day 5. Back to 95.9. Elvis Duran in the morning. And somewhere in between the skinny girl recipe for margaritas, which clearly I'm not interested in, and another secular song that I don't even recall, I heard, come, sit, make yourself at home in my house. Wait, that was random. Make yourself at home in my house. That, my friends, is why I'm sitting today instead of standing to talk to you. And I encourage that all of you do the same thing. You come, you sit, and you make yourself at home in God's house. That's the way I'm going to get through this. I might get a little shaky, and I'm sure you'll notice it, but I'll keep going, and I'm going to make myself at home here, and I'd like you to do the same. This morning, while I was running through this story in my head, which, by the way, is a true story, I as much as I wish to think I could make that up, I'm just not that creative. Another thought popped into my head that I decided to share. When we here at the Odyssey pick our music every week, we go through these songs and we only have a few days to practice the songs. Some of them I'm familiar with, some of them I'm not. Many of them I heard on 88.8 The Bridge when I was talking to God on my way to work every morning. This week, one of the songs was the song you just heard, Build Your Kingdom Here, also known as We Are the Church. It was supposed to be a congregation song initially. Rob and I panicked. It's got that Irish undertone, and we are not professional musicians. We got scared. We went to Pastor Rob. We made a unilateral decision without his permission. Don't know how he feels about that, but hopefully he'll forgive us. And we decided to do it as he opened. This morning, I was thinking about that. And you know what God said to me this morning? It works perfectly. Because the truth of the matter is, this may be his house, but we, people in it, we are the church. It doesn't matter what building you're in, it doesn't matter where God's house is that you tend to go to, it's the people that are the church. So the song actually fit. And once again, God has shown me that he is working through us, even though we don't realize it. So, I'm going to tell you some other ways that God's been working through us here at the Odyssey Church. We have a few announcements. Obviously, I think most of you saw on the screen earlier that we're having a barbecue this afternoon. We would love for you guys to stay and fellowship with us and get to know us better, get to know the church better. On Wednesday evenings, we have our small group, which is called Starting Points. It begins at 6:30 every Wednesday. Pastor Rob is usually in the lead until the rest of us kind of take over and ask him questions that fluster him, which happens quite frequently. It's enjoying to see. If you haven't seen it yet, you should come visit. We have our Forge youth group, which is growing by leaps and bounds. Rob and I have been handling Forge every Friday night in our meetings from 6:30 to 8. We have a ton of stuff going on. You'll see in your welcome packet this morning that we have a cornhole tournament, which is a fundraiser for Forge. It's next Saturday on the 22nd. There is a $10 entry fee to participate in the tournament. However, there will be free kids games for all children all day long with prizes. We'll have ice cream, we'll have hot dogs, we'll have drinks. You're probably wondering, why do we need a fundraiser for such a small group? There's lots of reasons. I have two young men here somewhere, but I think they're actually in the lobby right now. We just bought them t-shirts. That costs money. Nothing unifies a group like matching shirts. So our prior fundraisers we used for that. The rest of the money that we raise as our group grows will be used for fun trips because they deserve to have fun. They work hard for it. It'll also be used for outreach programs in the community where the children will do projects in the community, donating their time as well as a portion of the money that they raise. So the group is actually comprised of mostly 12 and under. We have two teenagers currently involved as volunteers. We're looking for two more teenagers to step up if they can. And I think I see one back there in the back row. See what else we have. Did I forget something? Did I? On Sunday mornings, you see we have snacks out here. And we'd like people to sign up to donate for the snacks just to keep us straight, because if nobody signs up, we bring it ourselves, and we've found in the past that we end up with a whole bunch of donuts, and I don't think we offer too many of those. That's it. But welcome to the Odyssey Church. We'd like to see a whole bunch of new faces today. I hope you enjoy the message you hear, and I want to ask Rob back here to lead us in a quick prayer.
Dear Lord, bless everybody here today. Bless Pastor Rob when he gives his message. Bless everybody who leaves here today. Everybody get home safe. And hopefully there's people here that need the message that's going to be given today. He'll bring them a little closer to you, God. We just thank you for this Lord's Day that you continue to give us. We thank you for the building that you provide for us. And last of all, I'd like to thank you for everything that you do in all of our lives, the little things that we take for granted, including the big things that we thank you for. And I hope today we just thank you for the little things. In your name, I pray. Amen.
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 You guys will all stand up and join us in the song if you're able or willing. We appreciate it.
Anybody feel like they may need grace to forgive someone else? You know, isn't that a pretty amazing statement? Because all of a sudden we know the commands of the Scriptures. One of the scariest commands in Scripture to me is where to give us the Lord's Prayer. You know, Lord, forgive me as I forgive those. And I'm not always that good a forgiver, so I have to change that prayer. Lord, forgive me as you forgive, not as I forgive. But again, I want to take the time to welcome you all, and just thank you for being here this morning. We got some special things planned. I know you may be here for the barbecue, but that's okay, because we're just going to love on you, and we appreciate you, and we think that really that this is God's house, and we should do and be what God calls us to do. And he says there's only one way. When he boils it down, he says a lot of ways to be disciples, but he says really the best way to do that is just to know that you'll be known as your disciples by the way we love. But we just pray we need grace to love some more time anytime you want to. Anyway, as we get started.
Pastor, I've heard the Lord this morning. I heard him through Tara. She said to make it like you're at home. Make yourself at home. And in my home, I stand up and speak. Uh-oh. Speak the word the Lord's put in my heart.
Well, come on up here, brother. Say what you got to say.
Those of you that received Pastor Rob's email, and maybe you just heard him say that he got some surprises for you today, I'm one of the surprises. All right, I'm on. Testing.
No.
I'm going to make myself at home here. Rearrange furniture a little bit. This is how we roll with me, Bill. There you go, I'm here. That mic stand go. I mean the
music stand.
One of the songs to you. in Psalm 43, verses 3 and 4. Verse 3 says, "Send forth your light and your truth. Let them lead me. Let them bring me to your holy mountain, to your dwelling place. Then I will come to the altar of God. To God, my greatest joy, I will praise you with the lyre." That's like a confession guitar. "God, my God." What this speaks to my heart this morning is before we can genuinely come to the altar of God, before we can truly worship God and offer Him sacrifice of praise, or sacrifice of the gifts that He's given to us, before we can honestly call Him God, my God, He must first send forth His light and His truth. With that in mind, let's pray. Father, we do thank you so much that you brought us all here this morning. We thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to meet and gather in this building that so many across the world cannot. We thank you, Lord, that you indeed send forth your light and your truth. You call us out of darkness. The only way we can love you or love others is because you first loved us. Help us, Lord, to take that into our hearts today. Help us, Lord, to use that as a starting point as we read and speak your word. Father, let everything comes out of our mouth be of you. The time for study is done. The time for prayer is done. The time for meditation is done. Holy Spirit, we welcome your presence. We look forward to what you have to say. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
All right, before we dig into the scriptures, I want to tell you a little bit about myself by way of demonstration. So I brought some brought my trunk, and it's got the junk. Here's the world. Here's the family I was brought up in. Here's me. I was raised in a church-going household. Mom took me to church as early as I can remember. And very early, I heard the Word of God. It came into my heart. Came into my brain. And I understood up here who God was, who He is. Understood the Trinity. Understood how what Jesus did on the cross. How the Holy Spirit has been sent to be our comforter. I understood it all up here. It didn't drop that 18 inches down here. So I guess I was about 11 or 12 years old, and it came time to rebel a little bit. It came time to sow a little wild oats, wanted to check things out for myself. And one of the guys I knew growing up smoked cigarettes. I thought he was just as cool as a moose. And I thought that was it. So it didn't take long before I started that. And added them to my life. And I smoked it like a kid, you know. All flamboyant about it, so everybody could see it. Thought that was pretty neat. And I guess it was pretty close to my 12th birthday, shortly after, when I got confirmed into the Episcopal Church, that I was introduced to alcohol. They had Cold Duck wine. I don't know if any old timers remember Cold Duck. I see a head shake. It tastes like Welsh's grape juice, slowly carbonated, and got kicked to it. And my cousin and I stuck a couple bottles of that up into her room. We both got confirmed together. And after drinking about half of that bottle, I got violently ill and was glad because then I could drink some more the first time. And had found a new love in my life. So it didn't take long before I started stealing beers from my uncle and my father. I added that to my life. Got me some beer drinking. So that was good. I worked at a restaurant where I could easily steal beer from there too. And I had a buddy, a drinking partner. We'd spend the night at Reese's house. His dad knew what was going on. He had a shed in the backyard. We called it our drinking shack. And that's where we went, to the drinking shack on weekends, drank. But, you know, beer fills you up so much. And my dad had a liquor cabinet and was a social drinker, had all kinds of different stuff. So what I would do would be take a jar and put a little bit of this, a little bit of that, a little bit of this, a little bit of that, a little bit of this, cream, mint, booze, rum, vodka, everything, put it in this jar, take that to the drinking shack on weekends, and we'd shake that thing up real good, get it all mixed up, and put it in the liquor, and then chase it to beer. So, as you can imagine, didn't taste well, but it really got a good buzz. So now I got hard liquor and beer, and of course the cigarettes. This was in the 70s, and this was post-hippie culture, so we knew about marijuana. We knew about drugs. We wanted to try it, but it wasn't as prevalent as it is nowadays. It wasn't even as prevalent as it was, well, probably 5 years later, 10 years later when I ended up in college. But you could find it, and there was a guy called Shorty, about this tall, and he almost like Cousin Dick. Well, the Adams family, a hair about down to here. I mean, everybody knew he was heavy, and he was a local drug dealer. So we went to Jordan and said, Jordan, we'd like to have some marijuana. And he said, well, I don't have any marijuana right now, but I got something that's just like it. He said, but it's in pill form. And it was called Purple Microdots. Now, for you young folks that don't know what Purple Microdots are, maybe some of you old guys don't either, it is similar to LSD. It's a hallucinogenic, it's a psychedelic drug. And he told us that was pretty close to marijuana, so there we took those. And so at the ripe old age of probably 14, my buddy and I are tripping, drinking that mess. But we finally did talk Shorty into getting some pot and technology. And actually, because we were getting into playing sports, the pot worked better than the alcohol as far as getting a buzz and not feeling so bad the next day and being able to stay in shape. So that was my life through high school. It didn't take long as I got older to realize that you could only drink so much and then you black out. So I got into amphetamines. Not too many, just, you know, 3, 4, 5, 6 a day. To keep myself awake so I could drink, get a good buzz, playing sports all the time. And so you add to that pornography, marital sex, thieving, bad mouth of the Lord. Got a pretty good picture of what my life is like. I was on the run. The Lord and the church and anything involved with it, the last thing on my mind. I knew enough here. I thought I had my ticket stamped. I thought I was covered. I was going to do things my way. And I hit the highway. So, I'll get back to that. Actually, I'm going to take a nice big swig out of that. But before I do, I want to talk to you about a story in the Bible. There's about another guy on the run. If you'd like to read along with me, it's the book of Philemon. You can easily find it. If you know where Hebrews is, you go, it's one book before that. It's one page long, one chapter. Don't know the chapter, it's just a letter, different verses. If you'd like to read along. I've chosen this book. It's very precious to me, and it's very precious in my relationship with Rob. We met in 2003 at a men's retreat up in Guardville, Pennsylvania. And one of the teachers there,
gave this message. Well, that weekend, the first time I went, Rob had been going for a couple years, I think. So as I was praying, getting ready for to give this talk today, I thought, gosh, what better book to use? What better time to kind of tie this together? Of course, that was the Spirit telling me that it kind of brought things together. So I'd like to read this story to you. Bear with me, it's just a short little letter. Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus, and Timothy, our brother, to Philemon, our dear friend and co-worker, to Apphia, our sister, and Archippus, our fellow soldier, and to the church that meets in your house. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I always thank my God when I mention you in my prayers, because I hear of your love and faith towards the Lord Jesus and for all the saints. I pray that your participation in the faith may become effective through knowing every good thing that is in us for the glory of Christ. For I have great joy and encouragement from your love, because the hearts of the saints have been refreshed through you, brother. For this reason, although I have boldness in Christ to command you to do what is right, I appeal instead on the basis of love. I, Paul, as an elderly man, he was 60 at the time, okay, maybe we're elderly now. I, Paul, as an elderly man, and now also as a prisoner of Christ Jesus, appeal to you for my child, whom my father had begot while in chains, Onesimus. Once he was useless to you, but now he is useful to both you and me. I am sending him, a part of myself, my very heart, back to you. I wanted to keep him with me, so that in my imprisonment for the gospel, he might serve me in your place. But I didn't want to do anything without your consent, so that your good deed might not be out of obligation, but of your own free will. For perhaps, this is why he was separated from you, for a brief time, so that you might get him back permanently, no longer as a slave, but more than a slave, as a dearly loved brother. This is especially so to me, but even more to you, both in the flesh and in the Lord. So if you consider me a partner, accept him as you would me. And if he has wronged you in any way or owes you anything, charge that to my account. I, Paul, write this with my own hand. I will repay it. Not to mention you, that you owe me your very own self. Yes, brother, may I have joy from you in the Lord. Refresh my heart in Christ, since I am confident of your obedience, I am writing to you, knowing that you will do even more than I said. But meanwhile, also prepare a guest room for me, for I hope that through your prayers, I will be restored to you. Epaphras, my fellow prisoner in Christ Jesus, greets you. And so do Mark, Aristarchus, Demas, and Luke, my co-workers. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit. Amen. You know, Pastor Rob and I, we meet for coffee once a week. We meet to the Arby's with a couple other guys. And we don't write letters back and forth, letters of encouragement. But we do give each other encouragement and guidance and direction. We hold each other accountable. We stomp on each other's feet quite often. Through the Lord Jesus, using his letter as our guide. We are indeed, but we are brothers. So I thought it was appropriate to share this letter to Philemon this morning, because it's from a brother to a brother for. God willing, we'll look at this snapshot of these three brothers' lives, and we'll see the Jesus. It's from a brother, the Apostle Paul, the same Apostle Paul that wrote many of the letters and epistles and commentaries in this book. It's to a brother, Philemon, and it's for a brother, Onesimus. This letter was written about 60 AD, approximately 30 years after the ascension of our Lord. The Apostle Paul had his conversion on the Damascus Road and knew that his ministry was primarily to the Gentiles. And he had taken his show on the road, he'd been on a couple of missionary journeys, and he'd been arrested a couple of times. And he wrote this letter while he was actually in captivity, awaiting his audience with the Emperor Nero. He was under arrest for spreading the gospel. Now, it wasn't like prison nowadays. One of my sons works in the Snow Hill Hilton down the jail, and well, I tell you, it sounds like three hots and a cot to me. And I think actually there's some guys that actually start committing crimes this time of year just in winter in the jail itself. I've heard stories of it before. It wasn't like that back in these days. It was no three hots and a cot. When you were in captivity, you were responsible for your own provisions. You had to get your own food, get your own clothes. The Apostle Paul talks about it in numerous times. Bring me books, bring me parchments, bring me clothes. What they did was, it was similar to what we call house arrest. They didn't have a little electronic bracelet, though. What they would do would be chain you to a Roman guard, and you were in a house or perhaps in a building of some kind. But that's how they kept track of you. You were chained to a Roman guard. Now the guards had shifts. They were just like turnkeys nowadays have shifts. They would go home to their families at night. They would come and go. But now the prisoner, he got no shift. 24/7. He's chained to another man, chained to a guard. But in the midst of all that, he could receive company, he could receive provisions, he could send out letters, and that's what this letter is to Philemon. It's a letter that Paul read while he was in captivity in Rome. And he's sending this letter to his brother, Philemon, his brother of the Lord. Now we know that Philemon's a believer, because in the letter it says in verse 1, dear friend and co-worker in the church, he's married to Apthia, our sister, in verse 2, and he most likely, Archippus, is his son, who is also a soldier of Christ. So what we have here is a Christian family living in a Christian home who welcome other Christians into their house to worship and share, as we're doing here today, giving testimony, give praise. That's how the early church started. It wasn't until about 300 years later that people started building buildings, renting buildings, to meet it. In the beginning, that was it. It was house church. And you hear stories, people nowadays, there's still house churches going on. But that's all there was for the first 300 years. So that's what we got. We got a Christian family. This letter's to this Christian family from the Apostle Paul. Pretty sure that the Apostle Paul never went to Colossae, which is where this family Philemon lives. Pretty sure what he did was Paul went through Ephesus, which is around the corner, probably 30 miles from Colossae, that Philemon went down to Ephesus and heard the gospel preached, and was converted somewhere, somehow, under Paul's ministry, and then took that knowledge, took that grace, wisdom back to Colossae, and specifically to his home. We know Philemon's pretty well off just from this letter. He had a house that was big enough to accommodate the local church. So it wasn't a little one-room shack where they ate, slept, and cooked, and did everything all in one shot. We don't think. Because later on in the letter, Paul actually says, prepare a guest room for me. So, pretty sure that Philemon was fairly well off. We also know that he was a slaver. And slaves weren't cheap, unless you could capture them yourself. People bought and sold slaves back then, very similar like we did here in America a lot of years ago. And slaves were property, just like you buy anything. You buy a house, you buy a car, you buy any of these physical things that we see. When you bought the slave, he was yours. You could do what you wanted with that slave. You could treat him good, treat him bad. There was no laws protecting the slaves. You could beat them, you could abuse them, you could rape them. There are stories of when they would get sick, they'd use them for fish food, for entertainment. And that's what this letter is written about, the slave, Onesimus. There's some estimates to say a third of the Roman population at the time were slaves. This was a huge enterprise. So you got a Christian family who are slave owners. You got to wrap your head around that. It's difficult for us in this day and time. Okay, how can that be? The Bible never really, unless you read between the lines, takes a strong stance against slavery. Though the Apostle Paul, a couple of places, said there's no more any Gentile or Greek or slave or free or man or woman. And that's what he was talking about. That we're all one in Christ. So, directly the Bible doesn't speak about slavery, but indirectly. What kind of slave owner Philemon was, the Bible doesn't say. We can assume, since he was a believer, his wife was a believer, his son was a believer, they had church in their house, that they were converted, they had gentle hearts. At the time of the writing of this letter, we can be pretty certain that he wasn't treating his slaves unfairly. You know, a lot of times, if you got yourself in debt, you could actually sell yourself into slavery. I read one commentary because there's a verse in the back of this letter when he says, bring him back not just as a beloved brother in the flesh. There's one commentary that says this Onesimus may have been Philemon's brother, his own blood brother, perhaps a half-brother, that got himself in a financial mess, made some bad decisions, sold himself into slavery, and then his brother Philemon, who had some bucks, obviously, bought him, paid that debt, so that he could make sure he wasn't abused as a slave. That's just an opinion. It's not in the book. It sure sounds a lot like the prodigal son. So, I think there may be some validity to that. But either way, we know that Philemon was a slave owner, Onesimus was a slave. Paul's writing a letter to Philemon about it. Now I'm going to take some liberties, but bear with me. You know, I think one night, after it got dark, whether Onesimus was fighting his brother, or whether he was bought into slavery, or born into slavery, we don't know. I think one night, Onesimus got tired of being a slave. He saw the wealth of Philemon's house, the freedom Philemon had, the freedom Philemon's son Archippus had, because they were free men. I think Onesimus decided to up and run. I just, you know, I got a picture of him grabbing the pillowcase and sneaking through the house and grabbing the candlesticks and the silverware and the valuables, the gold, and anything he'd get his hands on out the door he went. Onesimus, the word Onesimus means profitable. And I think one night Onesimus became unprofitable. I think he took advantage of Philemon, and off he went. What he took, the Bible doesn't say. How long he was gone, the Bible doesn't say. Who he talked with, who his cohorts were, what he did exactly after he left, the Bible doesn't say. Where he went, the Bible does say. He went to Rome, about 1,000 miles away from Colossae. He went to Rome to go hide amongst the rest of the dregs of society. You know what we do when we're overrun? We're drinking and drugging, we hang out with drinking and drugging. When we're slaves to sin, we hang out with other slaves to sin. We blend in, we get lost with the crowd. I think that's what Philemon did. That's what Onesimus did. He went to Rome to hide from Philemon, hide from the slave traders, hide from himself, but primarily to hide from God. But God had other plans. Somehow he ended up with Paul. Paul's in prison. Whether he knew about Paul because his master had been converted by Paul, we don't know if he knew him beforehand or not. Most likely he did. Whether he sought Paul out, maybe he got to the end of his rope. But I can't do this anymore. I remember this Apostle Paul. I remember this freedom in Christ. I got to give me some of that. We don't know. All we know is he ended up with Paul as one who used to run hard, drugs, steal. I think the business just got himself in a heap of trouble. I think he got caught on the run. They must not have known he was a slave or they sent him back. I think he ended up in jail with Paul. God has his ways, doesn't he? So, here we've got a slave who's on the bottom of the social ladder. And we've got the Apostle Paul, who's a well-educated, well-thought-of man, pretty much top of the social ladder. We've got the two of these guys in some kind of relationship. Don't know how it went down. Don't know what kind of prayer he said. Don't know exactly how it went, but Onesimus got converted. Onesimus became a believer in the Lord Jesus under Paul's ministry. And Paul, as evidenced by his letter, says, I'd love to keep you here. You're a wonderful servant. You're tending to me. Onesimus, you got to go back. You've got to go back. You've got to go back and make things right before I leave. You got to go. Now, we can't just think of this la, la, la. Him going back. He's a runaway slave. Worse than a runaway slave, he's a thief in one of those runaways. He's a thieving, lying, cheating, runaway slave. Roman law was pretty clear about what you do with runaway slaves. Most of the time, they killed them right off the bat. They didn't mess around with them. They didn't get to be chained to a Roman guard, as the Apostle Paul, who's waiting for his audience with Nero, was. A runaway slave was most of the time just killed on the spot, especially if they're 1,000 miles away from their owner. They're not going to spend the money and the time to get him back. They kill him on the spot. It's time the owner doesn't want him back. Who wants a thieving, lying, cheating runaway slave? At the very least, they would be beaten within an inch of life. At the very, very least, every runaway fugitive. At the very least. So when the Apostle Paul says, Onesimus, you got to go back, Onesimus knew this is what he could possibly face. This wasn't like, oh, well, I'm born again now, I'm all free, I got freedom in Christ, I can just kind of, oh, everything's going to be fine, I'll just hang my cross around my shirt and everybody know I'm a Christian and put the fish bumper sticker on my chariot and everybody in heaven. Wasn't that way. He had to go back to make things right. And he was in danger. So that gave him the courage to go. Not in the world that Paul ever talked about. Because you know that in Mississippi, Paul, I can't go back. Well, what if somebody stops us on the way? Paul says, show him the letter. You got a letter in your hand. Show him the letter. Well, what happens when I get back to Philemon? You know he's going to be mad at me. You know he knows I stole from him. Well, what am I going to do? Show him the letter. Show him the letter. That letter's got your name. That letter's all about you. Show them the letter. Church, this is a precious picture of the Lord Jesus done for us. Paul said, if he's done anything, put it on my account. If he owes you anything, put it on my account. That's what the Lord Jesus has done for us. I used to be scared when I died. This is after my conversion. I thought that I was going to go to heaven and they would, you know, videotape Russ Snader's life. And it ain't pretty. Oh, I heard this precious teaching. And the Lord said, show him the letter. Your name's in here. This letter's about you. It's about you. It's about all of us. When we come before the Father God, he's going to say, how about what you did? Show him the letter. Jesus is righteous. I'm righteous. Jesus is pure. I'm pure. Jesus is a victor. You might say, well, I don't feel like a victor. You're going to look at the letter.
Amen.
A victory. I don't feel white as snow. Look at the letter. Amen. That's why I've been washed clean. Show them the letter.
And we're kind of love alone. And word of our
testimony. Amen. Amen. When God comes into our lives, no matter what's in there, he takes that Holy Spirit. Sometimes fast in one shot. Sometimes kind of slow. Other times, bit by bit. Ounce by ounce. Yeah. Well, little by little, he washes it clean. Mm. I told you I was going to take a drink of that. Oh, isn't that telling? Still have amphetamines down at the bottom.
But I don't like amphetamines.
This is a wonderful picture of salvation. You know, if we walk out of here with nothing else today, own it. It don't matter. It doesn't matter what we've done. Name's in the letter. We're covered by the blood. The same word the Apostle Paul uses for put that on my account, it's the same word that Jesus used, imputed righteousness. we are justified, just as if we've not sinned. I heard a guy say last week that we were guilty, or found. It's as if we're not guilty. That's not quite right. We're guilty. What we did, what you've done, you are guilty of it. When you're found not guilty in a court, you walk away and don't pay a fine. It's as if it never happened. You were not, excuse me, it happened, but you're not guilty of it. You walk away without a fine. This is different. You're guilty. You did it. You've done it. There's a fine that has to be paid. It's as if we are found guilty in a court of law, and the judge says, I'll pay the fine, and on top of that, here's $1,000 if you don't do that. It sounds like a little difference, but it's the big difference. Own it. Name's in the letter. As I was studying for this, that's the message I heard on the weekend that Robin and I went to. And it set me free. It set me free. I've never been the same after that. It was a milestone in my walk. It meant so much to me that I've been back every year except for one to that new tree. But as I was studying for it, God put something else in my heart. I want to talk to you about it this morning. You know, we know what this did for Onesimus. We know the courage it gave him. We know the victory it gave him. You know, I don't feel courage. You're in Christ. You have courage. I don't feel victorious. You're in Christ. You'll have victory. You know, I can't fly. You're in the airplane. The airplane flies. That's how it works. As I was getting ready for this, I started thinking about Philemon, the slave owner, the one who was wrong. You know, like we've all been wrong. Somebody, probably somebody close in our family. What faith did it take for Philemon to welcome this lying, cheating, stealing, maybe brother back with welcome, open arms? Oh, you don't know what he did to me. You don't know how they treated me. You don't know what they said about me. Oh, I'll forgive them. But I'm not going to be in a relationship with him. That doesn't mean I have to be in a relationship. Excuse me, Pastor. Bull. You know what Paul was saying in that letter? Get this. Philemon, I'm not going to order you to do it, even though I'm an apostle. I could. No. I want you to do it out of your own free will because it's going to refresh my heart. Don't you see, church, when we forgive others as they've forgiven us, the rest of the body sees it and goes, whoa, that ain't nothing short of a miracle of God. It's not for us that we forgive. It's not for us. It's for the Lord. It's for the glory of His Spirit. If you got pain or you got hurt this morning somebody's done to you, let it go. Let it go. Today's the day of salvation. Let it go. You can, if you want, you can come up here and I'll pray with you. If you want, pastor can pray with you. Don't let today slip by. Maybe you're the runaway slave. Maybe you need to have some water poured in. Today's the day. That's why we're here. This isn't happenstance. It isn't because you love me that you're here. God has brought us all here today. If you've got a burden, lay it down. Lay it down. For the glory of God, you don't know how much it will strengthen the church. You don't know what God will do to it as your friends and family see it. As you let the Holy Spirit work in your hearts. Father, I bless you and I thank you. Lord, I thank you for the message of Philemon and Onesimus. Thank you for the reconciliation that took place, not just between you and them, but between them as brothers. Lord, thank you that we know that they reconcile, but we wouldn't be reading this letter today. More than that, Lord, we know that Ignatius wrote a letter 50 years later to the Bishop of Ephesus, Onesimus. We thank you, Lord, that you can take heathens, dirtbags like us, and turn us into your children. Be with us, Lord, this afternoon as we walk this thing out. Help us, Lord, as you've touched our heart and opened our hearts to share and to draw closer to you. We ask this in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Amen.
I want to thank Russ for coming up today, and I hope that you got as much out of that message as I have. Russ, I tell you, I'm thinking about what you said, and I'm thinking about how many Ten Commandments you were able to break in pretty much a single day. Think about this. Number one commandment, put the Lord first.
Wouldn't put the Lord first.
Number two commandment, no idols. God wasn't your idol. Everything in the world was your idol. Number three, and I don't know whether you ever lose the Lord's name today, so I won't skip that one. Number four, honor the Sabbath. I don't think you were honoring the Sabbath. Number five, honor your parents. I don't think at 12 years old when you're smoking, drinking, and drugging, you really honor your parents. Number five is honor your parents. Number four is honor the Sabbath. Number six is thou shalt not kill. Don't know whether you were angry, because Jesus said even if you're angry in your heart, it's the same as murder. So I'll give you that one. Number seven is don't commit adultery. If you've got lust in your heart, Jesus said you commit adultery. He was already there. Number eight, thou shalt not steal. Already admitted to stealing, so I can't give you that one. Number nine, thou shalt not lie. Already admitted lying, can't give you that one. Coveting. You were coveting. Ten. Out of 10 almost, by your admission, you were breaking. Here's the amazing thing. Philemon, our God in heaven, said, son, my child, Paul, who's an example of Christ, I said, put it on my account. Jesus said, put it on my account. It's all done, it's over. We don't know how important this is until we realize that we're omniscient in the story. We are omniscient. We're liars, we're cheaters, we steal, we covet, we do it all. And if you've never, ever put your trust in Jesus Christ, let today be the day of your salvation. If you're harboring anger against somebody, Jesus says, that's the same as killing them. Come and give it to Christ today. The story doesn't mean, God gives us these physical pictures of these spiritual truths. And if you read this la la la, you miss the point. Prophets of old, every one of them said one thing as their main message. Repent, for the kingdom of God is near. John the Baptist, last Old Testament pastor, even though he's in the New Testament, before Jesus had gone to the cross, he says, as he's announcing Jesus, repent and believe the kingdom of God is near. Jesus himself, his first message, if you read the scriptures, his first message as he walks out of the desert, as he begins his earthly ministry, his very first words were, repent and believe, for the kingdom of God is near. Jesus' brother, James and Jude, basically the same message. Paul's message throughout the temple, repent and believe. If you're involved in something you know you don't need to be involved in, if you've never accepted Christ as your Lord and Savior, today's the day of your salvation. Please repent and believe, for the kingdom of God is near. Russ and I are both here. I'm going to pray. If you feel led, come up to the altars. Come up and see us after the service, whatever. Time is getting short. Whether Christ is coming back to us or whether we're coming to Him, we're one day closer today than we were yesterday. So I'm going to pray for you. Pray for the food outside. We thank you so much for being here. You've really blessed my heart. You've blessed our church. And let's go outside and enjoy two of my favorite four-letter words, free food, and let's just fellowship and just love on each other as Christ commands us to do. Heavenly Father, we thank you for Russ's message. We thank you for his heart. Lord, we thank you for the people that have gathered here today. And Lord, we know there's people here today who were brought today specifically to hear his message. That they know their life is full of this junk. They look inside and they see this darkness. And by the power of the Holy Spirit, this living water can be poured into them and they can be clean. They can be as white as snow. Father, we come to you today. We thank you for the food that's provided. Those that have taken time out of their days to cook it and bring it in. And Father, just let us enjoy your company along with the company of each other. Remember that we don't serve this far away God. We serve this very present God. And let this food nourish us. Let us fellowship in your name. And as we go forth our separate ways, Father, let your light shine through our cracks. We ask this all in the precious name of our Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen. God bless you. I'll meet you outside in a few minutes, and you just start lining up and eating, okay? God bless you. Thank you. You are dismissed.
Food's in the lobby.
I guess the food's in the lobby.